I really like that one.
And
you just have morning saints. Good to see you this morning. We had a wonderful Christmas Eve service last night. We were quite full. And so good to see many of you here this morning. Warm welcome to you. For those of you who haven't met me, my name is Alan Smith. And I've been here for the last 6 months. And it's been a joy serving the Lord here at Emmanuel. And for those who haven't met, I hope that I will meet you more and as we'll see more of you around Emmanuel in this coming year. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning, and we thank you for the joy and the privilege of celebrating the birth of Jesus. Lord, in the midst of a world with so much trouble, a world that is crying out for a Savior, knowingly or unknowingly, we pray, Lord, that we will not just be those who celebrate this great event, but we will also proclaim it to a world in desperate need. So, Lord, we ask your blessing upon this time together, and particularly as we celebrate the birth of our Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thanks, Lena.
Good morning, Emmanuel, and Merry Christmas to you all. If you can just turn to the person next to you and greet that person. A Merry Christmas.
Be silent.
angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Let us sing Once in Royal David City.
To us a child is born. Now to us.
great. Let us sing the next song prayerfully, Away in the Manger.
Acceptance that Christ Jesus came to the world to say, sinners, Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The prayer for today, O Christ,
light of the world, all you should remain in joy, give us celebration of your birth, make us all witnesses of your love, to the glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Let's say together the baptism of the creed. I believe. Thank you, Father. We have our first reading now, the Pavilander, from the books of Hebrews.
Suddenly, a great company of enemies
God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those and whom he is faithless." When the angels left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried and found Mary and Joseph, and the baby was laid in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word according to what has been told about to them about this child. And all who heard it was amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord.
Thanks, you can please sit. Seats were reserved for them. And yeah, my gosh, you know that you stole the show this morning? How amazing! I just think often with little kids, they steal the show. They're not going to forget this service ever. And I've recorded it, so I'm going to show my whole family, and we're going to check it out again and again. I'm discovering life is a discovery. If you're not learning new things all the time, you're getting old. You've got to discover new things all the time. And I discovered that not everybody loves coming to the midnight service. How amazing is that? Like yourselves. That's why you, you know, you weren't here last night. You don't believe it for those people, you know, don't know better. So I said to one of our parishioners, I said, "Listen here, are you coming to the midnight service?" She looked rather shocked and embarrassed at me and said, "No," and then she went on to explain. "The last time I came to the service, I brought my husband along and he fell asleep." So that's probably a good reason not coming to that one. But I heard another story about a couple who also came to the midnight service. And he fell asleep because his preachers are silly. They think that because these folk haven't been to church for the whole year, so they're just going to give them everything. So that they preach for an hour or something like that. And this is what the preacher did. And of course, the hubby fell asleep and he started snoring. She took a hymn book and she smacked him on the head. He woke up and looked at her surprised and said, "Do it again, I can still hear him." Story told about a little boy who looked up into the night sky and he asked his mother, he said, "Mummy, is God up there?" His mother assured him that he was, and replied to the second question, "Mummy, wouldn't it be nice if you'd put his head out and let us see?" Now friends, this has been the cry of the ages. It's been the wish not just of little boys, but of adults and prophets and people with great insight, spiritual insight. If only God would come down. Isaiah talks about, says, "God, why don't you tear the heavens open and come down?" The prophets knew this. They knew that we cannot be the people that God wants us to be unless God comes down. And so in various ways the prophets spoke about it. And they would see this day when God would come down in human form, what we call the incarnation. And so they talked about this over and over again, and we've heard some of the words this morning. Wonderful, thank you for the worship as you wove all those scriptures in this morning, Glenda. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." How amazing is that? If you heard those words, wouldn't that put a longing in your heart and say, "Yes! I'd like to see that day as well." Not only to know that it's happened, but I'd like to meet this person. This message of Christ was made known to people over the centuries. People spoke about it, but it was strange that even though they spoke about this great event, they weren't quite sure what to expect. And so when Jesus arrived, What do we find? That there wasn't even room for him here on earth. Every door was shut. Not only were physical doors shut, but people's spiritual doors in their hearts were shut to him as well. Mary knew this as she heard the angel says, you will be with child and give birth to a son, and you will give him the name Jesus, Savior, Emmanuel, Son of God. And her faith response was not just those words, oh, isn't that wonderful? She said, be it unto me according to your will. You know, if you want to experience the Savior, it's not just good to hear the message being proclaimed year after year. You have to take a faith response. You have to step out and do something. It's one of the reasons why I've always been a sort of great salesman for something called Alpha. And if you know me, often people know that I would never preach a sermon without mentioning something called Alpha. It's a wonderful journey for you to discover what faith is really all about. Systematically, it will take you through some teaching, but you'll also go away on the weekend so that you can encounter this one, the Savior, by the power of the Holy Spirit. The shepherds knew it, so we see high and low. Different people knew about this great event to take place. To the shepherds, they were told, today is born for you in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And again, there's a faith response from them. They say, let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. You too can meet this Jesus. Not just hear about it, you see. And the Bible says, don't just be hearers of the word. There's something sad when a person hears all these things and they do absolutely nothing. Which is the reason that great Oxford professor C.S. Lewis, who became a Christian in his latter days, spoke about this. He says, you have two choices, really. You can either look at this, what Jesus said about himself and what the Bible says about Jesus, and you can say this man is a madman and just simply reject it. But you cannot be indifferent to who this person is. You can know him, and he can walk with you, he can talk with you by his spirit. He will do this to you, and he will guide you up. Don't we all need somebody who can guide us? We all face challenges as we did over the last 2 years, and we're not always quite sure how to respond. Some of us have made bad decisions. We're facing a new year, and you can have the guide of the Holy Spirit guiding you every step of the way. You don't necessarily have to make those bad decisions. And so it is true that even though this great news is proclaimed, as we did over the last few weeks, through our carol services, through our Sunday services, also on a Wednesday, and so on, yet so many people are clueless about this great event. And so they hear it, and they don't really put their trust in Jesus Christ. Do yourself a little exercise, maybe over dinner. You know, I didn't know what you guys were going to chat about. You can chat about the weather, not quite sure what's going to happen, and people are like, what kind of weather is this in the middle of December? Or you can chat about something sort of more interesting. For example, you can ask people, what did Christmas mean to you today or this year? That'd be an interesting discussion, wouldn't it? Story tells about a teacher, the first day they were back at school after the Christmas vacation, and the teacher was not ready for the school and not overly prepared. So she used a good bit of the morning going around the room and asking each child to tell how they spent Christmas. The first girl said, well, we are Catholics. We went to the midnight mass and we came home and we went right to bed. The next morning, we had a big breakfast, we sat around the Christmas tree, and we opened all our many presents. The second child said, we are Methodists. We did about the same thing. We went to Christmas Eve candlelight service. We came home and we went to bed. We had a big Christmas breakfast, and we opened all our presents. The third child said, well, we aren't Christians, we are Muslims. But we did have a big breakfast. We opened all our presents around the tree. And then we all got into the car and we went into town. We went into town to my dad's supermarket. He showed us all the empty shelves. He opened the safe and he showed us all the money that he made over the past week. And then we made a circle around the cash. We joined hands and we jumped around and we said, what a friend we have in Jesus. Yesterday, in the weekend of August, there was a front page article and it read, Bumper Church Crowds for Christmas. So I sent it to some of my pastors' groups and told them, I look what the newspapers are saying about it. They eagerly responded to me, send me the whole article, we were to read all about it. Well, I think the next question I will be asking them later today or tomorrow, was that prophetic word by this journalist correct or not? Did you have bumper crowds or not? Did people come back? Have they emerged from this sort of COVID apathy and just staying at home and just forgetting about this great event and so on? What has been the experience? What is your experience of it? A question worth asking. You see, Christ wants to enter in. He wants to come. And that's why we sing those songs that are just full of so much meaning and impact. God wants to be real to you. He wants your faith journey to be something exciting. I see one or two people, probably a little older than me, and you probably say, as older folk often have to say to me, says, Alan, we wish we had your energy. Or we wish we were as young as you. Let me tell you, you don't have to be younger. There's always excitement when you walk with Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Every day is a new day, and it can be. I can take you through a number of people, both in the Bible and elsewhere, who started afresh with ministry, with something exciting in their 70s, their 80s, and even their 90s. You know, for example, that Sarah gave birth when she was in her 80s. And we know that people like Caleb said, Lord, give me the mountain when he was 80 years old. I'm a little way from 80, but I hope that when I reach that age, I can do that as well. If you're not sure about this, you're going to talk to me, because I've seen this happening in people's lives all the time. And sometimes it's just going to do with what you have in your hand. God wants you to take a step of faith. But you see, so many of us don't know how to walk by faith. I'm walking down that step over there. I'm so glad they don't have a cross there. But that's what is needed. It's required for you to take some step of faith. Don't just sit there and hear this message. You know, James says anybody who hears the message and don't put it into practice, it's like a person looks in a mirror and walks away and forgot what they saw. Hello! God wants your life to be exciting. And this is what Christmas is all about. It's not just about singing Christmas carols. It's not just about giving presents to one another. And that's a wonderful thing to do. Thank you for those who gave me presents. I've been giving you a long time, but I've already received presents. So thank you for that. And it's wonderful to do that, but so much more. Don't let your life become boring. Don't let it end just simply with the service today. Let it become something more as you go on into the future and you grasp this wonderful gift that God has given you. Your life should never be the same once you have encountered Him by the power of His Holy Spirit. And I can tell you stories over and over again. In actual fact, you come here next week.
Amen.
I'm going to take the Sunday off. I don't know if that's a good idea to say. But they get to share stories of people's lives who have been impacted and changed by Jesus and the power of His Holy Spirit. Mm. I pray that you will take a step of faith. That's what it's all about. Not just sitting there taking a step of faith. And that's why sometimes we say, stand or raise your hand or pray this prayer so that you may do it. Don't let your Christianity be something boring. It's something so exciting. And God wants it to be exciting for you as well. Amen. Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thanks, Elizabeth. We will have our singers now.
Peace. Our Savior Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there shall be no end. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Peace be with you.
and the majesty, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. All things come from you, and of the hope that we give you. Lord, bless us and bless these gifts for your glory and honor and for the extension of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The Lord is here.
He
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him we have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born as man who died on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving spirit, and made us a people for your own possession. And now we give you thanks, because by the power of the Holy Spirit you took our nature upon himself, and was born of the Virgin Mary's mother, that being himself without sin, he might make us clean from all sin. Therefore, angels and our angels, and all the kind of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, ever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna.
Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and as we promise example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Spirit these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. With the same night that he was betrayed, he broke and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, Heavenly Father, will you make his offering of himself made once for all on the cross and proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. As we look for his coming in glory, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray together, through him, and with him, and in him, by the power of the Holy Spirit,
with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, our Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
The bread which we break is in our sharing of the body of Christ.
We are meeting our own body, for we all partake of our body.
Jesus, Lamb of God,
have mercy on us. Jesus, bear our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus,
Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you, feed on you in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. We invite all those who know and love the Lord to come and share with us at the table of the Lord.
Jesus.
pray. May you have a blessed Christmas and enjoy the lunch. I love Gavin. My wife always laughs at me. I says, I don't eat chicken on Christmas Day. So let's pause as we give thanks to God for His great goodness and the joy and the privilege that we can gather together this way. Gracious Father, thank you for this time together. Thank you that we can celebrate with the family of God in this place with so much joy. Thank you for so many people who put so much into it, getting this place ready, tidy, cleaning up. Thank you, Lord, for the music and the dance. We worship you. We thank you, God, for your great goodness. Thank you for all these different events helping us to celebrate this great event. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious.
His mercy endures forever.
And so, in the light of the word that we've heard, we respond by praying this prayer together.
Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
At this time, we want to speak God's blessing over Africa, especially our country. Challenges. God bless Africa,
protect our children, transform our leaders, heal our communities, restore our unity, and give us peace through Jesus Christ's sake. Amen.
In the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you. Amen. Thanks, Glenn. What's our final song?
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. Let's stand as we sing together.